Welcome this morning. We would like to welcome all of you who are worshiping here with us today and those worshiping online at trinitybradenton.com. And be sure to fill out that white Connect card that's in the back of your pew this week and every week. And if you cannot tell, I'm getting over a head cold. So if you're having trouble understanding me, that's why, because I'm talking through my nose. Shelby, this would be a good day for me to sing bass because I'm a lot lower than I normally am. So on New Year's Eve or New Year's Day, the Sunday closest to that, our Methodist tradition has been one to renew our covenant, John Wesley's covenant prayer for the new year. And before we begin announcements and go through some things coming up over the next couple of weeks, I'd just like to for you to join me in unison. It's not going to be on the screen or anything. I'll recite this and just lift up this prayer to the Lord as we begin into 2017 and look forward to a new 2018. I am no longer my own but thine. Put me to what thou wilt. Rank me with whom thou wilt. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering. Let me be employed for thee or laid aside for thee, exalted for thee or brought low for thee. Let me be full. Let me be empty. Let me have all things. Let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thou art mine, and I am thine. So be it, and the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen. Some other things that are going on this week today, as a matter of fact, is Fifth Sunday. There are special envelopes in your pew pockets for the UMC Florida Children's Home. Your generosity is appreciated. And I know New Year's Day is traditionally a day you all love. It's a tradition here in Bradenton and at Trinity to come to the church office, but you can't do that tomorrow because the office is closed, okay? Pastor Rick, if you're upset about that, Pastor Rick made that decision. So I'm just kidding. No, the office will be closed tomorrow for the holiday. Sunrise Cafe, just as a note, this week is closed. Discover Trinity will be next Sunday, January 7th. Join Pastor Matt for free lunch and a great conversation about what Trinity is all about. Call Rachel in the office and let us know you're planning on attending. And as we begin this hour of worship, our final hour of worship for 2017, let's go to the Lord in prayer. God of grace, we open our hearts, minds, and souls to worship you this morning. Thank you that as we gather together, we join with all Christians across the world to glorify your holy name. Come be with us, inspire us, and lead us in our time together. As we prepare for the beginning of a new year, we echo these words from the Book of Common Prayer. Grant, O God, that your holy and life-giving Spirit may so move among every human heart that barriers which divide us may crumble, suspicions disappear, and hatreds cease, that our divisions be healed, and being healed, we may live in justice and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good morning. Happy New Year. What is the one word that comes to your mind when you think of going into a new year? Shout it out. What was it? Hope. Got any more? Resolutions. No, not resolutions. Refreshment, joy, love, peace. We're going to hit on all of those today, I think. Maybe even in our first hymn. There's a song in the air was first published in a Methodist hymnal in 1904. And our composer found the poem and then he set it to music. It's a beautiful carol and we don't sing it really enough. Let's stand and sing, There's a Song in the Air.
Remain standing as we affirm our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's take a moment and greet one another as we pass the peace. God, For those of you that are non-musical, that was a Picardy third. Wasn't it? Okay, I'll define that. It's when you're in a minor key and you end in a major chord, right? Okay, I was a music major. All right. Well, good morning, everyone. This morning, the white carnation on the altar is in loving memory of Betty Norris, who was the mother of Nancy Siegel and died on December 20th. This morning, as we go to prayer, we want to remember Barbara Baker, Shirley Bell, Chad Choate, John Collins, Billy Dean, Kenny Hawkins Jr., Billy Sue Hartman, Linda Lewis, Howard Longstreet, Nancy Siegel and family, and Gloria Warren. Also, please continue to pray for those in our neighborhoods and our families and our community. Let us pray. Our Father and God, this morning as we stand at the beginning of a new year, we confess our need of your presence and your guidance. We each have our hopes and our expectations for the year ahead. But Father, you alone know what it holds for us, and only you can give us strength and the wisdom that we will need to meet its challenges. Father, help us to humbly put our hands into your hand. Help us to trust you and to seek your will for our lives during the coming year. And in the midst of life's uncertainties in the days ahead, assure us of the certainty of your unchanging love. Father, in the midst of life's inevitable disappointments and heartaches, the things that we go through, the disappointments, help us, Father, to turn to you. Help us to realize that you are the stability and the comfort that we need. And in the midst of life's temptations, and Father, the pull of our own stubborn self, will help us not to lose our way, but to have courage to do what is right in your sight, regardless of the cost. And again, Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, and we pray as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine power and the glory forever. Amen. This morning, as the ushers are coming forward to receive our tithes and offerings, let's prepare our hearts to give. Again, there are contribution envelopes and commitment cards available for you in the pews in front. Let's pray. Father, again, we thank you for your provision in our lives. And God, as you have blessed us, we come today and we give with joyful hearts in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Lift up your eyes, your light has come.
That anthem was taken from our cantata, Morning Star, and the composer of that cantata will be with us in March for a composer weekend like we had last year. So it's going to be a wonderful weekend, and you'll be hearing more about that. We're pretty excited about that. Our next hymn is another one that we don't sing a whole lot. It's a carol, and it was written by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. How many have heard that name? I thought so. If you took high school English, sometimes we felt like it was beaten into us, right? But no, it's an interesting story. It's a story of pain and hope. He lived during the Civil War times, and in 1861, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow's wife was making candles, and she was standing. She opened the windows to get some air into this beautiful Virginia home where they lived, and the candles blew. It blew the fire into her clothes. And so when he was taking a nap, and when he heard her crying, he got up and he tried to save her with his own body, but he could not. And she passed away the following morning. He was devastated. He had 5 children, and one had already passed away. And he was burned so badly that he could not go to her service. And for the rest of his life, he wore this massive beard to cover the scars on his face from that fire. A couple of years later, his son, his oldest son, went to war without telling him he was going. So he was very devastated about that. And at times, he just thought about even checking himself into a mental facility. That's how desperate he was. And he sat down on a Christmas day. His son was wounded but came home and was fine. And he sat down on a Christmas day to write a poem. And I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day tells the story of hearing the bells and how at first it just made him worse. You know, he felt worse when he heard them. And then I don't know what happened. Maybe God spoke to him while he was reading this. But it ends up being his turnaround and feeling the hope that he had. So let's sing I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day. It's a beautiful, beautiful carol.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our reading this morning comes from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 5 through 8. This is the New Living Translation. Those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things, but those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about things that please the Spirit. So letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death, but letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. For the sinful nature is always hostile to God. It never did obey God's laws, and it never will. That's why those who are still under the control of their sinful nature can never please God. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Mary. Shelby, I want to thank you this morning for sharing what you shared. So often we sing the songs, you know, but we don't really understand the background of those who wrote the songs. And for me, it made it so much more special this morning. So thank you for sharing that. Don't you love our choir? I do. I just love them so much and appreciate it. Thank you, Shelby and Carolyn. You know, I also want to take a moment. Thank you, Jerry. Every Sunday, Jerry comes and shares, and he's got such a call in his life. Thank you, Jerry, for all that you do here, and your wife. Thank you for both of you. I love and appreciate you guys. You know, I don't know that we do this enough, but if you have a moment, just turn around and look up there. These people are what make this happen. This is Joni and her team, and thank you guys so much for all that you do. Let me pray. Father, again, I pray that you would open our eyes this morning to see the things that you want to show us, Lord. Open our ears to hear your word and receive that which you want to speak into our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, everyone, today is the last Sunday of 2017. Can you believe it? I'm not sure for some of us, but it seemed to fly by, didn't it? And then there's others of us this morning that might be looking in the rearview mirror saying, you know, see ya. Thank God that year's over with. Anyway, no. Let me be honest with you this morning. It seems to me that the older I get, the more I realize that as time passes and as the years go by, life doesn't always get easier. For a lot of us, there was nothing about 2017 that was any easier than 2016. There were moving parts that were more for me, maybe some for you. My schedule seemed to be busier than it was the year before. And, you know, I know that all of us sitting here this morning could say that our own personal lives with our jobs, our family, just things happening in our worlds, life can be really challenging at times, right? And of course, you know, the stress-producing things that happen in our life that even are painful at times can really be emotionally and spiritually and physically and even relationally difficult. And this morning, as we're looking forward to 2018, I want to teach a message that I believe has the potential of significantly impacting our lives and our year. I call it new thoughts, new words, new year. New thoughts, new words, new year. Let me ask you this question this morning. How many of you, I heard it a little earlier, how many of you make it a tradition every year to challenge yourself with a New Year's resolution? Okay, four of us. All right, well, boy, I feel like preaching now. Oops, sorry. Well, I'm going to ask you something this morning. I'm going to ask us, all of us, to consider something. Would you consider joining me this morning in one very simple, life-changing discipline that I think could be a life-changing and impacting thing for all of us today? And it starts with this realization. Listen to this. Our thoughts
matter more than we could ever imagine. Our thoughts matter more than we can ever imagine. If you're going to take something home today, you know, every time we come to church on a Sunday morning, I'm hoping that we all leave with a big takeaway, something that God spoke to us, something that God put in our hearts. And here's what the big takeaway I hope will be for all of us today. You ready for this? Here it is. Our lives move in the direction of our strongest thoughts. I'll say it again. Our lives move in the direction of our strongest thoughts. See, if our thoughts are full of faith, if our thoughts are filled with God's word, then we become more like Christ every day. Isn't that right? But here's the thing. If our thoughts are negative, if our thoughts are destructive, then they define our words, our actions, and you know what, choir? They also define our destiny. In our scripture that Mary read this morning from chapter 8 of Romans, Apostle Paul said this. I'm just going to bring it back for a moment. Just tell you. It says, those who are dominated. Everybody say dominated. That's a powerful word. Those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things. But listen to this. But those who are controlled, say controlled with me, controlled. Those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about things that please the Spirit. See, our lives are moving in the direction of our strongest thoughts. How many of you understand what an inner dialogue is? Okay, some of you are smiling already. How many of you talk to yourself? Come on, be honest. How many of you talk to yourself? All right. I think all of us do at some time. I talk to myself, and it's pretty normal unless you're having a group discussion, and that's not normal. That's a whole nother deal. Okay, but most of the time, I don't know about you, but most of the time, I'm going to confess, my inner dialogue is pleasing to God, hopefully most of the time. But the thing is there are times that my inner dialogue, I'm just going to be honest with you, is completely ugly. I just mean ugly. And I'm telling you, some of the things in my head, and I'm thinking, oh, dear. So here's the thing. I'm going to challenge you with a question this morning as we move forward. Maybe a couple questions, but this is the first one. Is your inner dialogue dominated by negative and critical thinking? Or would you say that your inner dialogue, your mind is controlled by the Spirit of God? Is it consistent, you know, with honoring Christ-directed thoughts? Okay? Now, you're thinking, what? How am I supposed to know that? So I'm going to give you a couple scenarios, all right? When you wake up every morning, do your thoughts during the day lean towards this? God is with me. Yes, my life matters. Woohoo! I've got purpose. I'm walking in faith. I mean, my mind is full of life and peace today, God. I'm ready to do whatever you call me to do. I can't wait to love on my family and everybody at work. And this is going to be awesome. And the guy that gives me the signal that's not good with his finger on the way to work, I'm going to smile and wave at. I'm going to make a difference in people's lives today. Yahoo! Or, do you kind of wake up and think this? Oh my God, where is the dang coffee? Sometimes I don't say dang, sorry. I'm tired, where's the snooze button? Some of you that still have children, who's the kid pulling on my leg this morning? Why did we have kids in the first place? Oh my God, here we go again. You know, oh Jesus, another tough week. Too much to do. I have to go to my stupid job, work with stupid people and my stupid boss, and life's overwhelming. Whatever I do, I just can't get ahead. And Jerry, are you confessing before God this morning? Yes, reading your mail this morning, and mine. Oh my gosh. Okay, I'm exaggerating a little bit. Maybe. But you know what, if we're really honest, you know, what would characterize the general dialogue that you have with yourself and your mind? See, when we recognize that God is with us, And we celebrated that this Christmas season. He's with us. His power is authentic. It's real. It's tangible. Okay? His grace sustains us. When we're weak, he carries us. In our weakness, his strength is there for us. It's made perfect in our weakness. In 2 Corinthians, look at this. Chapter 10, verses 3 and 4 says this. It says, though we live in the world, we don't wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of this world, but they have divine power to demolish strongholds. That's a powerful scripture. The Greek word, by the way, for stronghold is translated as this. It's like a castle or a dungeon or a prison. And the literal translation of this would be like a prisoner being locked up by deception. So it's someone who is in a prison and deceived into believing there's no way out. See, there's a lot of people in this world that they're caught up in strongholds and Christians as well, because, you know, it's a mindset or it's a spiritual trap and they think there's no way out. And here's the thing. Listen, every single one of you, if you look on the right and the left, in front of you and back of you, husband and wife, you can don't even tap each other, but here's the thing. All of us battle with thoughts. Amen? Thank you for being honest. So here's the thing. Apostle Paul is saying here that our weapons against this battle, you ready? They are spiritual and not on our own doing. You know, I get frustrated with myself. My biggest problem in my life really is me. How many of you know what I mean? And so I can't fix me. Brother Jim, I can't fix me. I get frustrated with the stupidity of myself sometimes. Oh, and so do we. Thank you. Well, my friend is honest. Thank you. But here's the thing. You know, the apostle Paul says that our weapons are spiritual. I think that's important for you to understand today, because you cannot fight a spiritual battle, you know, in a natural way. Or as Paul would say, in the flesh. I mean, you know, we're human, God is God, and there are things we just can't deal with on our own power and with our own ideas. And here's the thing. In Ephesians 6, Paul goes on to instruct us to be strong in the Lord by putting on what God calls the armor. How many of you heard that before? Sure you have. So Paul says that by putting on God's armor, we will be able to stand firm against all the strategies of the enemy. And who is the enemy? The devil. And don't think for one second that the devil is not real, because he is. So, Paul tells us that we have the sword of the Spirit. He said the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, the belt of truth, and our shoes prepared with the gospel of peace. There's a lot of things there that we can see and we can look at. I mean, the sword of the Spirit, let me tell you, the Bible and the Word of God is like a sword. And it's powerful. The Word of God is powerful in our lives. The righteousness, you know what? We have the breastplate of righteousness. You know, when God looks at you and I, you know what he sees? He sees forgiven. He sees Jesus, Christ in us, our hope. We are the righteousness of Christ in us because Jesus lives in us. Isn't that wonderful? And the shield of faith, you know, the Bible says the faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes from what? The Word of God. How many of you know it's important to hear the Word of God? Sure it is. The helmet of salvation, well, we're born again. Whosoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Isn't that wonderful? It's such a simple gospel. Believe and it's you. You got it. And then finally, the belt of truth. Yeah, we need truth because this world is filled and our culture is filled with things that aren't truthful. And our shoes prepared. And listen, prepared. Prepared sounds like preparation to me, which sounds like discipleship to me, which sounds like we got stuff to do. It sounds like we need to choose to put this stuff on. Listen, tomorrow begins a new year. Wow. New year, new thoughts, new words. So you and I today, we can choose our destiny, listen, based on what we think, which then leads to what we say, and in turn determines our lifestyle and how we live and our character, which determines our destiny. So, where do we begin? Thank you for asking that. Where do we begin? Thank you, Jim. First, we make sure that we spend time with God. Every day. We put Him first. That's a tough thing, because I have the hardest time not putting me first. In fact, the majority of the time, I deal with that, putting me first and not Him. But I know that He can help me because He gives me the strength to do it. How many of you know this morning that God is not Sir? God never in His word in the New Testament said to us, did He call me Sir? When the disciples came to Jesus and said, how do you pray? How do you do this thing? We want to know how you pray to God. Because, you know, for all these people, God was like I talked about last week. God was, you know, serious. He's holy. How could He possibly be with us? We can't even get near God. Moses couldn't even look at Him. Really? God loves us? And you know what Jesus told them? He said, here's how you start. He says, our Father. He says, Papa, Abba. So we address our Father by saying Daddy. Wow. Not Sir, but Daddy. Now, I don't know about you, but in order to have a Daddy relationship with God, there has to be a relationship. Right? How many of you know that I know about who our president is? Donald Trump, Obama, last time. I know who he is, but I don't know him. There's a big difference between knowing about someone and knowing him. I want to encourage you today that God wants us to know him. Relationship. Okay? Listen to this. This is powerful this morning in my life. What you and I ingest, what we take in visually, audibly, what we hear, what we see, what we ingest, we become. Let me ask you this. What are you ingesting in your life? What do you watch on media, TV, videos, if there are such things anymore? What do you read? What are you reading? I love reading. But the problem is, if I read novels and I read this and that and the other and I don't read the Word of God, I'm ingesting everything probably that some of it's maybe okay and some of it's not good. Who do you hang out with and who do you allow to speak into your life? Important questions. So, what you ingest becomes who you are. Are you guarding your thoughts with the Word of God? Because that will change your thinking and change your direction, because, again, what you think, you speak. What you speak, you typically do, and that is important. How many of you know what a topical Bible is? Okay? A topical Bible is a Bible that you can buy or go online and purchase, or you can... I'm using my Kindle to help me with my notes. A lot of things now are, on this kind of a thing. But a topical Bible helps you with certain areas in your life, like prayer. Okay, what are all the scriptures about prayer? I don't love very well. Well, what are all the scriptures about love? Boy, I'm just not very disciplined as a person. I wish I could work on that in my life. The topical Bible is very helpful. You can replace, some of the negative thoughts and things that you're dealing with, with God's truth. Look, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5 says this. Big, big, big scripture today. We demolish. Everybody say demolish.
Demolish.
Boom. We demolish arguments in every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. Other versions say we demolish arguments and thoughts that sets us up against the knowledge of God. How do we do this? How do we deal with our thoughts? By taking captive every thought and making it obedient to Christ. Another translation, the New Living, says this: we capture the rebellious thoughts and we teach them to obey Christ. So if you have a thought that's like, oh, did I just think that? Oh, dude, don't do that. That person that just, you know, is honking at me in the back. How many of you have road rage? Oh, nobody? Jerry's lifting up. There's nobody here that's ever gotten angry in driving. Okay. Okay, some of you, and some of you are going, raise your hand. What do you do? You know, it's like, I don't like that. I don't like getting angry. The worst thing for a pastor is if somebody, you know, somebody's like honking at you and you're getting ticked off. And it's some, yeah, and you don't want to give the middle finger thing. That's not good. Because you sometimes, how many of you know sometimes your thoughts and your actions go way before you thought them through, and then you do something and then they pass you by and it's somebody that goes to church. Yeah. But here's the thing. God gives us the power to overcome those things. We can choose this morning, it's our choice, to take those thoughts that are toxic and negative, and we can replace them with truth. Let me ask you this. What negative thoughts dominate your thinking at times? I made a list this week. Some of you may have a hard time with things like, you know what? I just can't get it done. What's wrong with me? You know, I'm just not a good mom or dad. I've not been a good parent or husband or wife or whatever. You know, sometimes I've heard people say, I just suck at this. Really? I'm inconsistent. I'm on again, off again. You know, I'm undisciplined. I just never seem to get ahead. What's wrong with me? I'm just not good enough. I'm just average. I'm never going to be good enough. You know, whatever it is, think about when your inner dialogue tips you to the negative side. What are you constantly telling yourself again and again? Because what those things are, go back to what I said earlier, your life moves in the direction of your thoughts. You know, if you this year want to go to the gym and lose 20 pounds, maybe that's something that you want to do, is practical, you know. But you get up every morning, you look at yourself, oh God, I'm fat. And you say, I'm never gonna lose weight. I can't do that. I just, oh man, I'd rather go get a cheeseburger than go to the gym. If you're challenged at your job in some way, and you know, I'm gonna tell you, the enemy is a liar. He speaks stuff into your head. You're stupid. You're not good enough. You'll never be able to do that. You'll not be this. You'll not be that. It's lies. Proverbs 18:21 says this: the tongue can bring death or life. Listen to that. The tongue can bring death or life. Those who love to talk will reap the consequences. Boy, the more you talk negative, the more negative you will be. The more you talk and think and believe God things, the more like God you will be. Change your thoughts. Change your words. You'll change your life. Maybe you worry. Change your thoughts. You know, if you are a worrier, your words could be this: you know, because of Jesus Christ and because he loves me, because I asked him into my life and the Holy Spirit is in me, I don't have to be anxious. I'm not going to be. I'm going to try not to be anxious, God. So help me with this. So I'm going to cast my cares on you, God, because you care for me. And I have your peace that passes all understanding in my heart. and it's going to ruin my mind day in and day out. Maybe you feel like you don't have any purpose in your life. And so every day you say, you know what? My life belongs to God. That's it. I'm going to seek Him daily. He's going to lead me to His will. And God's got me. Maybe you lack confidence. So every single day you begin to say this: my confidence is in You, God, in Christ and Christ alone. Your Spirit lives in me, and I can do everything You call me to do, because I know You would never call me to do something and not equip me to do it. And in my weakness, You're strong. It may not feel like it's truth at times, but you just keep believing it, and you just keep ingesting it. Let me ask you some questions this morning. Are you consistently speaking things that are God-oriented? Is God and His Word being given permission by you to renew your mind? You cannot renew your mind if you do not spend time with God. You cannot move forward into the things God has called you to do and be if you do not have a relationship with God. How many of you knew this morning, before you came in, that religion is poison? The one thing that angered Jesus was religion. Religion and relationship are two different things. Christianity is not about religion. It's about relationship. It's about knowing a loving God who sent His only Son to die for you and I. That is truth. And everybody said?
Amen.
Our words, our thoughts, and our imaginations can come under the power of God. We can take all of our thoughts captive and make them obedient to Christ. We can wake up with purpose, with direction, with meaning every day of our lives. How many of you have ever had an emotionally painful moment? I had an emotionally painful year, really. How many of you have been there? Death in our families, divorce, painful family things. Stuff happens. Can I be honest with you today? God never said in His Word that His job was to make us feel good. What God in His Word says is that when we're going through tough things, He'll give us strength to go through it. God isn't Santa Claus, but He's a good God. And I can't think of anything better than eternal life. How about you? You and I were the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Our world can be different in 2018. It can be better if we serve Jesus day in, day out, day in, day out. Can I say this? I mean, gosh, you know, I know I'm the assistant pastor, and I know Matt would be right here saying amen. But I'll tell you something. You have to learn how to self-serve. You have to learn how to grow on your own. Sunday morning alone, it's great coming and everything, but I encourage you, you know, spend time with God. I'm going to tell you something. If Sunday morning is your only God moment, it's going to be tough for you. You need to read the Word. That's what discipleship is. You need to get into a small group. You need to have accountability. We have lots of small groups here, and we're trying to think of ways to help people grow and become who God, you know, called them to become. Sometimes people come to pastors and they say, wow, that was tough this morning. I was looking for a motivational speech. You know, some Sundays are good to motivate, and that's what God's Word will do, but sometimes I like when people come up and say, wow, God really spoke to me this morning, Jim. That was convicting. I really dealt with me. Thank you for being honest and sharing the Word of God. See, discipline is all about, you know, working towards a goal to be like Christ. And can I tell you something? We can't just skate by. We have to make some choices. If I'm going to change my thoughts this year, I've got to really look at what I'm ingesting. I've got to really look at the time. Am I spending time with you, Father? Am I reading your word? Am I surrounding myself with people in my life who speak into it? I know I'm picking on you this morning. You know the reason why I love talking to you and hanging out with you? Because you're a pastor. Because you have a lot of experience, and you have gone before a younger guy like me. Oh, we're just a couple years different, right? Aren't you? Wink, wink. It's important for me to listen to someone who's been through things. So it is for you. Please, as you go into 2018, please look at the fact that if you want to change your life for 2018, you've got to change your thoughts, change your words. It'll change your life. You and I are called to make a difference, right? You and I have the mind of Christ, right? We have the same spirit, right, that raised Christ from the dead, dwelling inside of us, the Spirit of God. That makes us powerful for the kingdom of God. Gene, every time you go to the grocery store and somebody looks at you and you speak, God could be leading you at any moment. You don't know how many times you have ministered to me because of your strength and because of your life and some of the tough things you've been through, but yet your spirit. And you have blessed me and don't even know that. I'm praying today that God would speak to every single one of us, and that this morning, as we leave here, that we would all come together in our spirits, in our minds, so that we could look into 2018 as being the most effective, productive, and God-honoring year that we've ever had. I would love to invite every one of you to join me in going before God and letting him change us into the new people that he wants us to be next year, changing the way we think, changing the words we say, and changing for his glory how we live. Would you pray with me? Let's pray. Father, this morning, I would ask that you would inspire us. I believe that these people are serious this morning about living for you. God, you are such a loving God. You have never come before us with shame and judgment, but you always come with love and forgiveness and kindness and grace and mercy. Father, inspire us to seek you this year. Honestly and openly, and Father, transparently. I pray, Father, that you would change our homes, Father, that you would change our small groups, our community gatherings, everything that we do, where we sit around a table or in fellowship and we gather and open up your word. Help us to say things like, here's where I'm weak, here's where I'm vulnerable, here's where I've been talking myself down, I need help. God, empower us today for this next year to hear from you, to declare your truth in a way that would change our minds, that would conform us to the image of Christ. We want to live in the image of Christ. We want to please you, Father. Help us that we don't just hear this word today, but we do this word. Father, we're ready for this year to be more God-honoring than ever before. I know that in my life, and I'm sure all of us today would say this, I've been negative in my inner dialogue, and I want that to change. Father, I believe that we all today want our thoughts to honor you. We want our minds to be controlled by your Spirit. So empower us to change our thoughts. Give us words to live by. Father, we will declare your word. And we will faithfully pursue you as you renew our minds in 2018. In Christ's name, we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen.
I'm always amazed at how hymns that were written so long ago still speak to us today. And along the theme of what Pastor Rick has been talking about, taking time with God. Our last hymn, Carol, is It Came Upon the Midnight Clear, and it was written during the Industrial Revolution about 1849. In about 10 years, our country would be embroiled in the Civil War. So it was a tough time. And it was a time of upheaval and unrest in our nation. And this hymn was written, and it still speaks to us today because one of the verses said, "Rest beside the weary road and hear the angels sing." And I hope that you will take that theme with you today along with the message of hope that Pastor Rick has given us. And think about that. Think about taking time and listening to the angels sing. Let's stand and sing It Came Upon the Midnight Clear.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen.